And that $38 pays for their education, their medicine. It sends them to a Bible school and to Sunday school classes. It's a tough situation for these kids. A lot of them, you know, their parents are dead, from AIDS and stuff, and they got nobody to take care of them. So we've decided to sponsor these kids. And as you can see, most of it's filled out. But what I'm going to do is I'm just going to leave it here. Usually when I leave something here, people forget about it. Do you want that? Okay. And you can, if you want to pick a month. And we do things around here on the honor system. You know, no one's going to like knock on your door and say, hey, man, you sponsor this month. Pay up. You know, it's not the way it is. We're just kind of relying on you to remember. Once the list is finished, we'll put it up by the front door, you know, where the pictures are of Holy and Angel, and underneath will be the list. And so as you leave each week, you can kind of just take a gander and see when your month is up. And then you just take $38, put it in the box, put it in the plate. You can give it online, whatever. We've got it set up so it automatically comes out. So, you know, you just do your part. That'd be great. I'm just excited about this. I'm totally excited about this new thing that the men are going to be doing. It starts July 7th, and this is a study on steroids. Really, this is going to be an awesome study, and we're excited about doing it. It's called Stepping Up. It's a call to courageous manhood, and that's what this world needs. We need men to step up and lead their families, lead their church, lead their community. This course here is 8 weeks, and it's going to start on July 7th. And I'm happy to announce to you that we have had 21 men commit to taking this journey for 8 weeks and purchase books, and that's commitment. So I'm thankful for that. Yes, very, very thankful for that. All right, so let's just do this. Let's grab our Bibles and we'll open up to the book of Joshua. Open up to the book of Joshua right there in chapter 1. If you don't have a Bible, as we say all the time, but it's worth mentioning, there's Bibles all over the church. You can grab an orange one, you can grab a yellow one, and many of the verses that we'll share from the pulpit will be up on the screen. Not the verse, but the page number. We don't want to make you totally lazy. We just want to make you sort of lazy, so we'll give you the page number to one of those. But if you got your own Bible, we kind of figure you know how to get to it. And if you have a phone or something like that, well, that's pretty easy. You just type in the reference, and it finds it for you. So anyway, go ahead and grab one of those Bibles. That's lazy. I got one of these real Bibles with paper. Anyway, so we started this series last week, going through the book of Joshua. Don't know exactly how long it's going to take. If you guys remember, the theme verse for the book of Joshua is found at the very end of the book of Joshua, which is in Joshua 24, and it's verses 14 and 15. And he basically just says this. Joshua says to the people of God, "Choose today whom you will serve." And then he takes a stand as a man who's stepping up, amen? Yeah. A man who steps up and he answers his own question. He says, as for me and my family and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Can you bring me down a little bit, please? I'm even too loud for me. Thank you. So, that's the way we're supposed to be. We're supposed to choose to serve the Lord. And he goes on in this first chapter, we talked about this last week at length, to be strong and courageous, because the task before the man is going to be difficult. And the task before Joshua is no different than the task before any of us. It's going to be challenging. And for Joshua, there was a river in front of him, and there was stubborn people behind him, and there were people on the other side of the river that wanted to kill him. And so it's very, very challenging. And so God says, be strong and courageous. You're going to need to stand up under this thing. It's going to be a lot of pressure. It's coming your way. It's going to hurt. It's going to be scary, but stand up. But don't worry. The reason why you can do that is why? Because I'm going to be with you, God said. Okay? And that's the promise for each and every one of you. God is with you. God is with you. So this week, we want to pick up where we left off. Joshua chapter 1, we're going to start in verse 10, and we're going to read to the end of the chapter, then we'll go back and we'll see what God has for us out of this text. I want to forewarn you as we go into the evening, it's going to be a little bit different than what we normally do. We're going to spend some time, this is the part for you guys to go, freak out. We're going to spend a lot of time at the end of this message in prayer. That's a good thing, right? Can somebody say it's a good thing? That's a really good thing, right? We're going to pray. So, I'm just going to tell you right now that the prayer time, just be forewarned so you don't go freaking out, it's probably going to be 20 minutes plus of quiet prayer, time to work between you and God. Okay, so that's where we're going. But let me start here. Let me read this, and then we'll dig out some stuff that God wants us to learn. Joshua is in response to what the Lord had told him to do. Be strong, courageous, lead your people. And so he has to make a choice, right? That's what this whole thing's about, choices. And he says this, Joshua then commanded the officers of Israel, here's his response, go through the camp and tell the people to get their provisions ready. In 3 days you will cross the Jordan River and take possession of the land the Lord your God is giving you. Now, anyone out there know, how long were they marching around the desert before this day came? 40 years, right? Who's around 40 years old, give or take a few? Raise your hand. How long does that feel? Forever, right? Forever, a lifetime. And these people have been walking around the desert anticipating this day. And finally, Joseph comes to him and says, it's here, it's gonna happen, finally. And what do you think they're probably thinking? Yeah, right. Sure. In 3 days, you will cross the Jordan River and take possession of the land the Lord your God is giving you. Then Joshua called together the tribes of Reuben, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh. He told them, remember what Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you? The Lord your God is giving you a place of rest. He has given you this land. Your wives, children, and livestock may remain here in the land Moses assigned to you on the east side of the Jordan, but your strong warriors, fully armed, must lead the other tribes across the Jordan to help them conquer their territory. Stay with them until the Lord gives them rest, as he has given you rest, and until they too possess the land your God is giving them. Only then may you return and settle here on the east side of the Jordan River, in the land that Moses, the servant of the Lord, assigned to you. They answered Joshua, we will do whatever you command us, and we will go wherever you send us. We will obey you just as we obeyed Moses, and may the Lord your God be with you as he was with Moses. Anyone who rebels against your orders and does not obey your words and everything you command will be put to death, so be strong and courageous. Amen. Amen. So, we're talking about serving the Lord here, right? That's what Joshua says. Choose today whom you will serve. Choices in life. I place before you blessings and curses, death and life. Oh, God says, oh, that you would choose life. And serving the Lord comes with a lot of different looks, doesn't it? It's a lot of different things. I mean, there's the serving of the Lord that everyone knows about. It's pretty clear, like the guy who comes in and organizes the chairs and parks cars and greets people at the door. The formal kind of vocational tasks of serving in your local context. You guys know what I'm talking about, right? But there's other looks to serving the Lord too. How about just in this moment of whether you have to choose to be honest or lie? And you have to make a choice right then and there. Are you going to serve the flesh? Are you going to serve the enemy? Are you going to serve the Lord? We have to make a choice there. We have to be choosing what we spend our money on. Should we spend it on this that we might not really need? Or maybe we could save that and maybe we could be a little bit more generous, or maybe we can help other people rather than serving ourselves, to be good stewards, not only of our time, but of our bodies. Like, I'm guilty of this. I'm not a good steward of my body. I don't eat well. I don't exercise. These are choices that I make, and they're not good ones, and I know I'm not alone. But there's a moment of that of that choice that we have to make. We're going to serve the flesh, have another Twinkie, have another this, have another, or refrain and honor the Lord. I mean, there's those choices we have to make. There's those choices with our time budget. What are we going to do with today? What will we do with the day? You know, the scriptures say that today is the Lord, is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I was talking to Kyle. Everyone knows Kyle. I was talking to Kyle the other night on the phone. And he's talking about his perspective, and it's all too common, especially for men, that at the end of the day, like we might start the day saying that this is the day the Lord has given me. Rejoice. But at the end of the day, we have to look back on our day as men. I know this is common. And we look back at what we accomplished, and that decides whether it was a good day or not. Anyone with me, or am I the only guy who does it? Okay, it's guilty. It's not good. We have to make a choice whether we're going to serve the Lord or serve our flesh. What are we going to decide to do with our time? Now those, I don't want to say that those are little things, but those are things that you could kind of keep quiet. You can keep them under the rug if you want to. I could sweep if I want to not, you know, maybe not give as much as I should, and I could put it under here and maybe buy a little something for myself. No one's really going to know. It's not even going to affect that many people, to be honest with you. So I'll call it little in that sense, although it does have ramifications in your own life and longevity. But sometimes serving the Lord can be a little bit different than that. And I want to give you three things tonight, just three things. You'll see them as clear as day in the text. You may have already seen them when you read it with me just now. But I want to give you three ways that we serve the Lord that I wouldn't call small things. I think these are big things, and I think we all need to learn them. I needed to learn them, and I want to share them with you tonight. The first one here is this. Choosing the Lord to serve the Lord can be extremely, extremely scary. What do I mean? Let's look at the text first and see what I'm talking about. Look at verse 10 and 11. Joshua then commands the officers of Israel, go through the camp and tell the people to get their provisions ready. In 3 days, you will cross the Jordan River and take possession of the land the Lord your God is giving you. Now think about this for a second. In chapter 2, verse 15, it said that it was the harvest season and the Jordan River was overflowing its banks. Now, I don't know about you, I'm not the brightest guy in the world, but if you look at a world map and you can see a river on a world map, I'm talking about a far off view. If you can see that river on the map, then it's not a creek down the street, right? It's usually a pretty decent size river in length and width. It's to show on a map, you got to be able to see it. Well, if you look at a world map, you can see the Jordan River. It's a big river and it's overflowing its banks. So don't just think of a little creek going down the road. It's harvest time. It's overflowing the banks. And he's telling these people that, one, the river's overflowing, and they're standing, they're sitting camped right on its edge. They're not like wondering what the river looks like. It's right in front of them, and he's telling them, after 40 years, this guy Moses that you treasure and honor, and he couldn't get it done, but we're going to get it done, and we're going to cross that river in 3 days. You think he was scared that maybe it wasn't going to work? Do you think he's going out on a limb telling these people that this is going to happen? I mean, honestly, that's why I say sometimes serving God is extremely scary. He's got an army of armies, tons of them. Every little nook and cranny of land over there in the Promised Land has its own little king and its own army, and we have to go kill them. And they have to kill us. So we have to fight an army. We have to go over this river, through a river that's overflowing its banks. And the guy that you idolized, the guy you loved and cherish and honor, the king of all king Jews, the guy, Moses, he couldn't get it done, but I'm gonna. That's going out on a limb, isn't it? That's the kind of stuff I'm talking about. And I repeat this last week, I repeat it again this week, and Theo started it. God's gonna ask you to do some crazy stuff. And this is what I'm talking about. Sometimes serving God isn't just telling the truth at that moment of truth.
Sometimes it's not a matter of whether I should buy this or save it and be more generous. Sometimes it's, Joseph, I need you to go do cartwheels down the street right now. I'm telling you, good's going to come out of it. Go do it right now. Like, that's kind of crazy, right? And God will tell people to do some things. Like, listen, this is not uncommon for God. This is not uncommon for God. Think about Noah way back when, right? He says, Noah, this is what I need you to do. I need you to go build me a boat. What's that? Yeah, I need you to build me a big boat. And I want you to make it so big you can fit two of every animal in it because it's going to rain. What's rain? And it's going to flood. What's a flood? Yeah, but I need you to go do it anyway. And everyone's going to think you're insane. Right? Go out on a limb. This is what I'm talking. This is the stuff I'm talking about. I want you to go build this stuff, right? It's going to rain. How about Moses? In Exodus, he tells Moses to gather the entire nation together because you're moaning and complaining that you don't have anything to eat. I want you to gather them all up, all 2 million of them, and stand before them. And this is after 2.5 months of walking through, the desert. Now look, let's just say that this right here is the beginning of the desert, right? The desert. If I walk for 2.5 months into this desert, I want you to do me a favor. I want you to tell me what's on my left side. What? Desert and sand. How about over here? What's over here? How about over here? And how about back here? I just went to another. Right. So we're in the middle of nothing. Desert, sand, and what does he say? I want you to go in the middle of that, and I want you to tell them all, tonight we eat quail. Tonight we eat meat. Really, Moses? Apparently you don't see what I see. Because when I look all around me, I see nothing but sand. Maybe we eat some rattlesnake. But we ain't eating quail. And what does it say? A cloud of quail comes pouring into the camp and they start dropping out of the sky. And they had a feast. But he didn't know that was going to happen, did he? Moses didn't know that was going to happen, but God told him, stand up before everyone, risk your reputation, risk failure, totally be open to embarrassment. Your credibility could definitely be shot right now, Moses. Right now, Noah. Right now, Elijah. Here's another one. Mount Carmel. I want you to do me a favor, Elijah. I'm going to prove my reality to everybody. I want you to call everyone in the country. And I want you to call all the false prophets, too, that worship Baal. And I want you to gather them all up here at the base of the mountain. And this is what I want you to do. I want you to build, this is God talking. I want you to build me an altar. And I want you to stand there. And I want you to pray in front of everybody. Bring fire down. And my fire will come down and prove my reality. And he tells Elijah to do this. Now talk about a reputation that could be totally destroyed. Right then, everything, every bit of credibility he's ever earned, right? Could be right out the window at that moment. And God called him to do something absolutely crazy. Well, let me ask you this. Would you say, you? Well, what? Sure, but what if fire doesn't come down? Like, what am I going to do? What if fire doesn't come down? Right? I mean, is there anyone in this room that probably wouldn't say that? Well, what if the fire didn't come down? Like, what am I going to do then? Right? My reputation is shot. I'm done. So if you go to the story in 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 36, part of Elijah's prayer is this. Do this to prove that I've done this all at your command. Like, please, please don't make me look like a fool. You're asking me to do something crazy here, God. I'm scared. I might fail. Anyone in the story yet? Come on. And here's the beautiful thing about Elijah. The book of James, in the 5th chapter, in the 17th verse, it says that Elijah,
who called down fire from heaven, who prayed and it didn't rain for 3 years, and then he prayed again and it did, that he was a man just as you are. The New American Standard says it a little bit different. It says that Elijah was a man with a nature like ours. Does that encourage you? I mean, Elijah, this great, nothing in the Bible is there so you can, like, oh, he's an awesome dude. What an awesome prophet. I wish I could do like he. You can. He was a man just as you are, with a nature just like yours. Scared, God says, Lena, go do this. And what do? We do. That's natural. What if the fire doesn't come down? Then everyone's going to think I'm a fool. They won't listen to me anymore. My family will think I'm crazy. My friends will desert me. Everyone in the church will think I'm nuts. The town will shun me. Everyone will think I'm crazy. All credibility is shot. Serving God can be scary. Serving God can be real scary. We risk failure. We risk embarrassment. We risk ruining our reputation because we go out on a limb. How about this last one here, our perfect example, Jesus Christ. Remember the story of him at the wedding and the wine runs out? You guys remember that? I know y'all remember that. And so what does he do? So someone tells him, right? And he's like, all right, guys. He goes over to his guys. He's got guys. Jesus got homies. He says, hey, guys, do me a favor. Go get some of these jugs. Go over here and get these jugs right here, right? And I need you to fill it up with some water. Well, Elijah was saying, well, what if the fire don't come down? Well, what are you guys going to say? I know what I'm going to say. Hey, Jesus, come here. Psst, psst, come here. I know you didn't notice this, but we didn't run out of water. We ran out of wine. Yeah, but I told you to go fill it up with water. So if these guys go, I mean, everyone knows that there's no wine, right? So if these guys go and get wine, they go to the store and get wine, heroes. But what if they go to the spigot and they start pouring water in to the wine jugs? Does that make any sense at all? None. But God said, go do it, right? And so it's the same thing here. These guys, their reputation's on the line. People are going to call him a fool if it does. Why would you fill jugs with water when we need what? Wine, right? Why? Because God said so. And it's because God is with you. God is with you. In this case, manifest in the flesh, Jesus was there with them. And he said, go do it. And so you can rest assured that when God says go do something, you can go do it. Even though you fear that your reputation may be shot, that your credibility may be lost. Do it anyway. Do it anyway. And trust in the word of God that says all things work out for the good to those who love the Lord, and this is perfect, and are called to his purpose. And these men have all been called to his purpose. And they do it anyway, and all good comes out of it. I'm reminded as I was studying this of a song that we sing here often. It's a beautiful song. It's called Oceans, is what it says. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. Isn't that the story in all these? I would never do that stuff. I wouldn't build an altar. Pour. You know that Elijah was told by God to pour, to build the altar, to call down fire. Now, how many people start a fire with wet wood? That's not smart, right? It doesn't happen that way. So you know what God did on purpose just to make him even more awesome? He said, I want you to pour water all over it. Right? Come on, God. You want me to do what? Take me deeper than my feet would. I would never do this stuff. I would never stand before a bunch of people in the middle of a desert and say, tonight we eat steak. Like, are you out of your mind? Yes, I'm out of my mind. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. This is awesome. Why do we do that? Why does God do that? Why does he take you deeper? Where my faith will be made stronger. That's the next line of the song. Why? What did I say? What is the reason why you can do these crazy things? In the presence of my Savior. That's the next line, right? Because he's with you.
And what does Jesus promise at the end of the Great Commission? I have been given authority in heaven and earth, all authority in heaven and earth. Now go make disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teach them all that I've taught you. And oh, by the way, I will be with you to the end of the age. I will never leave you. I'm right here by your side. And that's why you could do crazy things. But it can be very, very scary. Very, very scary. Each day and every week, myself and several others show up here to pray and to plan and to work. Why? Why do we do such a thing? The reason why is because one man over 2,000 years ago said, go tell people about me and I'm going to build my church. He told us to do some scary things. You know, there's people all across the world. And I don't know what that is, but, oh, no. I need something for my nose is what I need. Like, no, a saw and cut the stupid big Jewish honker right off my face. That's what I need to do. Oh, I only don't fix it because I know how much Jessica enjoys my snorting. Yeah. I don't even know where I was. God is good. All right, good night. I have no idea what I was saying. What was I saying? Oh, we show up. You know why? We show up because he said to go do it. And there's people all across this nation and this world that are leading ministries that have forsaken great livings, and people shun preachers and pastors and ministry leaders. They don't like them. And they don't have the same respect that they used to. I mean, it used to be a day where a pastor was a man that was well respected and honored, and it's not like that anymore. And people have given up great careers. And why does a man who's making a couple hundred grand a year just walk away from all that and go to seminary to get a job where he might make 20? Why does he do such a crazy thing? Why? Because he believes, as we do here, that we're in the center of God's will and we in this gospel work, and we believe that we're witnessing the future promise of Christ, that he says he will build his church, and we're watching it become a reality right here. And so that's why we come and do this all the time. So, that's the first thing in the text. I think it's pretty clear that sometimes serving God is very, very scary. It's very, very scary. Here's the second thing. You'll see it there. Choosing to serve the Lord means choosing to be selfless. To be selfless. It is true that when you got saved, you personally, that your salvation changed your status. It changed your position. It changed your identity. It did. It was extremely your. In other words, it's personal. It is about you. You were once an enemy of God, the scripture says, but now you're a friend of God. He said that you were once a child of wrath. Now you're a child of God. You were once dead in your sin, but now you are alive in Christ. And that through Christ, he has brought you into his presence, into the presence of the holy God. And you are holy and blameless and without single fault. That's a good place for an amen. And in this presence where Christ has brought you, the scriptures tell us that there is fullness of joy. However, when I make this claim that serving the Lord means choosing to be selfless, I must support this thing. And I will say this, that built into the joy, where it says in the presence of God, of the Lord, there is fullness of joy, that built into this joy is the necessary component of sharing that same gospel that saved you with other people. That you cannot, I'm telling you right now, that you cannot enjoy the fullness of joy in God's presence unless you are sharing that same gift with other people. It is impossible. You might think that you got it all
when you got to the cross, but part of that means you must share it with other people. Let me show you what I mean. Go to 1 John chapter 1, verse 4. Well, you know what? The New Living Translation's terrible on this one, but you can read it if you want. It says this, John, the Apostle John, walking around with Jesus, knowing all this stuff, right? And he's writing stuff down in the scriptures. And he's got 1 John, 2 John, 3 John. This is authoritative writing here, right? Inspired by the Spirit. And he's telling people this. Let me read you the beginning. You can go there if you want, but let me read you the beginning, what he's talking about. He says this. He says, we proclaim to you the one who existed from the beginning. Now remember, I told you, necessary component. You got to share it. We proclaim to you the one who existed from the beginning. Jump down a little. He is the word of life. Jump down some more. And now we testify and proclaim to you that he is the one who is eternal life. He was with the Father, and then he was revealed to us. So let me just ask you this. He's basically saying he's sharing the gospel with these people, right? He's sharing the gospel. This is Jesus. This is the one, right? You need to come to him. Let me proclaim this to you. And what does he say at the last sentence of that paragraph? He says that I'm writing these things to you so that our joy may be complete. Now, that's not normal thinking. If I go to you, Kat, and I share the gospel with you, why? It's the gift to you, so you can have joy, right? Do you guys agree? Right? But what the scripture's telling us is that in my sharing of the gospel with Kat, I can enjoy fullness of joy, that somehow I cannot achieve that level of joy that God wants for his sons and daughters unless I am out sharing that same gospel with others that was shared with me that brought me eternal life. That was good preaching. Take a look at the text. See what I'm talking about here. Look at verses 12 through 15. Then Joshua called together the tribes of Reuben, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh. He told them, remember what Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you. The Lord your God has given you a place of rest. He has given you this land. Your wives, children, and livestock may remain here in the land Moses assigned to you on the east side of the Jordan River. So see, they haven't crossed over from Jordan into Israel. There's that body of water there. There's that river. And so Moses gave these people some land over there. And now what he says is, like, your families can chill there, but you have to armor up, and we got to lead the other tribes across the Jordan to help them conquer their territory. Stay with them until the Lord gives them rest as he has given you rest, and until they too possess the land the Lord your God is giving them. Only then may you return and settle here on the east side, right? Only then can you come and truly, fully enjoy all that God has given you. So you can go there. You've been given this land. So that's awesome. You've been saved. If you've been saved, you should celebrate. It's awesome. You've been saved. But now, wait a minute. Before you're going to enjoy the totality of your salvation, you need to go and help Donna get there too. You got to help Chris get there too. You can't just sit there and go, hey, I'm saved, I'm going to heaven, to hell with everyone else. That's not the way it works. You got to enjoy the fullness of your salvation. You have to have that component of sharing that same gift of everlasting life, the gospel that saves, with other people before you can go home and enjoy all that God has for you. You have to go and share it. Now, there's some more there, though. More to be learned. Do you guys get that? You good? Take it to heart, man. That's important. That's why Jesus said, go share. Go tell people about me. Go teach them. Share the good news. You got to go do it. Now, look what it says here. It says, there's some more here. It says, the Lord your God is giving you a place of rest. Then he goes on and says, now you can't rest necessarily until you go help other people get to their place of rest. So the Lord has given you a place of rest. See, in Joshua's day, rest was a place. You get that? Rest was a place. Rest was the promised land. It was a place where these people, after hundreds of years, could go and there'd be no more slavery. There'd be no more bondage. There'd be no more taskmasters overseeing them. They could live life the way they wanted to. They could have a family. They could flourish. They could farm. They could harvest. They could worship as they desired. That was the place of rest, where they wouldn't be freaking out, worried about stuff anymore. That's a modern-day vernacular. But since, here's the thing, and we all know this. If God, this I've said this before, it's worth mentioning again. If God, the one that we worship, if he's really the one true God, if he's the only real God there is, then doesn't it make sense that everyone should worship him? And don't you think it makes sense that that God would desire and deserve the worship of every, if he's the only God? I mean, if he's not the only God, then that's, I get it. But if we believe it, right? You with me? We believe he's the one true God. So everyone should worship him. And he, if he's the only God, he would want all people to worship him. Now, he started that work with Israel. He started the redemptive work with Israel, bringing people back to him. We fell at the beginning, and now he's starting to bring people back to him. It starts with the nation of Israel, and he brings them to a place of rest. But now, think about this. He's the one true God. He wants everyone to worship him, right? Well, if he wants everyone to worship him, every tongue, every nation, every tribe, are we all going to move to Israel? Are we all supposed to move to, because that's the place of rest. Are we all supposed to move to Israel? I don't think so. You guys seen it on a map, right? It's about the size of a French fry. Do you know how many people live in Israel? 8.4 million? 8.2 million? You know how many people live in New York City? 8.4. Okay, so by the time you put New York and LA into Israel, they've reached capacity, right? They've hit their, you know what I'm saying? Their occupancy load has been triggered. They need sprinklers. That was only appropriate for us. I didn't talk about that, but we're still working on that. Don't give up praying. It's getting there. Okay, it's a small little country, right? Funny how that small little country is the hotbed of all, it's the most important little spot in all the world. It's crazy, right? Little thing, like Rhode Island or something. But we can't all move to Israel, can we? Does that make sense? See, so we're not going to move them into a place of rest. Today, rest isn't a place, it's a person. Remember I told you last week, that this all started with it being in the shower and thinking, man, Yeshua, Joshua, wait a minute, that sounds awful familiar. Yeshua, but that's Jesus' Hebrew name, and that's Joshua's Hebrew. They have the same name, the deliverer. Both of them are deliverers. That's who they are. See, but back then, see, Joshua delivered people to a geographic place of rest. That Yeshua led them to a geographic place of rest. The Yeshua we know, Jesus, he's leading people to a personal place of rest. You see, there's a difference. I want to support every claim that I throw at you. Look in Matthew 11. I love doing this, guys. I just thank you very much for the privilege, really. Matthew 11, this is Jesus talking. Verses 28 and 29. We're talking about a place of rest. And in Joshua, he says, like, don't go enjoy your rest until you help other people find their rest. And it's the same thing today. Yeshua then, Yeshua now. What does Yeshua say? Jesus said, Yeshua says, come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens. Anyone not on that list? Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. That's the first indicator. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because
Because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light. I will give you rest for your soul. See, peace and joy and rest and prosperity isn't necessarily like a pot of gold and a hammock in the Bahamas. Rest from God shouldn't matter what the location or the situation, whether you're in Israel or Libya or Sweden or China or in jail or in the desert. It doesn't matter where you are. He's not delivering you to a place of rest. What God wants is for you to have a person, a personal place of rest in Christ. And what he wants to try to do for you is to give you rest for your soul, no matter what the situation. No matter what comes your way, you can say what? It is well with my soul. That's what he's looking for. And you know what? You don't have to move to Israel to get there. You don't. You can have it right here in Eustis. You can have it right here in Eustis. So serving the Lord can be scary. Serving the Lord will be selfless. You got to forego your own fullness of joy for a moment and go help others find their way there. Now, I needed a drink because this is a tough one. You know, sometimes there's stuff in Scripture that you don't want to talk about. Nobody likes to come to church and hear everyone talking about stinking money all the time. It's uncomfortable. But Jesus talks about it, right? So you can't, who am I? Who am I to decide, well, I know Jesus talks about money, but I'm not going to talk about it. No. But I promised you guys a long time ago that as I chose by inspiration, I'm hoping, a certain book of the Bible, that I wouldn't dodge issues because it made me feel uncomfortable. I was afraid of it. And here we are. We're at that place. Now this here, it's as clear as day, but it's in the Scriptures and it talks about me. And nobody wants to go up here and talk about themselves. It's uncomfortable. But it doesn't matter what I think. I'm nothing. It doesn't matter what any of you think. This is what the text says, and we have to approach it. Are you with me? You always let me do this. Don't leave me hanging. Serving the Lord means following spiritual leadership. Let's go back to the text. Refresh what it says. I'm not making this stuff up. I don't like it. It doesn't make me feel all good and gushy. It's just what it says. Joshua told him what to do, and they answered Joshua, "We will do whatever you command us, and we will go wherever you send us. We will obey you just as we obeyed Moses. And may the Lord your God be with you as he was with Moses." Now this next part I'm having trouble with, and I'm sure you can understand why, but I don't want to dodge it. And I'm not saying we have to live up to this thing right now. I'm not. But I just want you to see the seriousness of this. "Anyone who rebels against your orders and does not obey your words and everything you command will be put to death." And they follow it up with this last statement, like, it's going to be hard, but we're with you. So be strong and courageous. See, the people encourage Joshua here to do this, to hear from God and follow what he says. Like, don't be afraid, Joshua, to get away into your closet and to get on your knees and to hear from the Lord and obey what he says. The reason I say they encouraged him is they didn't use those exact words, but what they did is they spoke with their actions. They said, "You could do this because we commit to following you on that journey. So we're giving you permission and the authority to do that. Go listen to God. And listen to what he has to say. And when he says it, Don't be afraid to come to us because we're with you, Joshua. We're with you. And that's what the church needs. The author of Hebrews talks about this as well. Let's jump over to the New Testament. Hebrews chapter 13, right at the end of the book. Verse 7 and verse 17. Remember your leaders who taught you the word of God. Think of all the good that has come from their lives and follow the example of their faith. Look at verse 17. Obey your spiritual leaders and do what they say. This is when you hear this, like, I've sat there. I've been in your seat when I've heard this preached, and it makes my skin crawl. Because I don't want somebody standing before me telling me, you need to listen to me. Like, that doesn't make you comfortable. Does it make anyone comfortable? No, I get it. Does anything in the Bible make you comfortable? It's not supposed to. It's supposed to get you out of your comfort zone. Obey your spiritual leaders and do what they say. Their work is to watch over your souls, and they are accountable to God. Give them reason to do this with joy and not with sorrow. That would certainly not be for your benefit. You see, what the people there around Joshua did is they said, listen, go and meet with the Lord, hear what he has to say, tell us what to do, we'll follow you. Give them reason to do this with joy and not with sorrow. And that's exactly the gift that the people of Israel gave Joshua. They gave him the gift that said, Joshua, go hang out with the Lord and hear what he has to say and do your praying and do your fasting and get away with him. And when he tells you to do something, just come to us, tell us what we're supposed to do, and we'll do it. We'll follow you. And that's what the church needs. Man, I meet with pastors every month, and if there's one thing, there's one gift that every one of us would want, would be a flock that would trust him and go for it. That's what we want so bad. We want it so bad. We want it so bad. See, I recognize the fact, and most of the pastors and preachers recognize the fact, that the majority of the Christian body is not at home in the closet, on their knees, facing the book, studying, fasting, praying. Like, I understand. I wish we all did, and I'm sure if we all would vote, we'd say, yeah, we'd all like to do that, but the truth is that we're not. But there are people who are doing that, and those are the people, and if this is not your church and you go to another, that's okay. Follow that guy, and you test the person, though. You test the person. You see what, if are they doing that? Are they fasting? Are they praying? Are they studying continually? Are they active? Follow the example of faith. Are they the ones passing out the basket and say, you should give, but I don't? Or are they giving generously? You should pray more. Do you pray, Moses? If I don't pray, you shouldn't pray. Don't follow. No, you know what I'm, no, you should. You know what I mean? Don't listen to me if I don't do it. Hey, quit smoking, man. You know what I'm talking about? The parent who says, hey, quit smoking. Yeah, put that out for me, kid. Go get me another pack of smokes. Quit smoking. It's bad for you. Like, who wants to listen to that guy? Paul says this in 1 Corinthians 11, 1. Follow me as I follow Christ. See, God loves you. Do you guys know that God loves you? God loves you. He loves you, and he doesn't want, remember he said, I'm not going to leave you alone? And sometimes, a lot of times, that comes in the form of a spiritual leader. That's why Paul said that, follow me as I follow Christ. Paul realized the condition of the human race. No, not everyone's sitting there like on it all the time. And so, but Paul was, you know Paul was, right? He was singing hymns in prison. He was praying like crazy. He was serving like crazy, traveling around, getting whipped and beaten, serving the Lord like crazy. He's an amazing example to follow. He was following Christ to the letter.
And so you know you could follow him. And that's when God says, I won't leave you, a lot of times it's because he leaves a man or woman in your life that follows him to the letter. And you can watch that example and you can copy that example. I have those people in my life. He told us a long time ago that he would do this. Jeremiah 3:15 says, I will give you shepherds after my own heart who will guide you with knowledge and understanding. I will give you shepherds after my own heart. These, bum, 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 bum. Bum, 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 bum. Okay, cool. I will give you shepherds after my own heart. In other words, these are people that God will put into your life and you could see the example of Christ. Was Christ loving? So will that leader be loving? Was Christ a servant? Well, then that leader will be a servant. Was Christ generous? Like, he didn't have a bunch of cash, but that what he had, did he give? Yeah, he did. So we can see the example. We can see the Christ-like character in these men and women that God puts into your life, and you can follow them. And you can follow them. Acts chapter 6 talks about it too. It says here, you know, the church first started, it was experiencing incredible growth. It was a new thing. No one ever heard this stuff before. But it was growing by the thousands. It was crazy. And so what happens is all these people are coming to the church now. Now just imagine, if you will, if like 3,000 to 4,000 people just within a matter of a month or so showed up at this church. Like, that would be cool, right? But along with that coolness would come a lot of problems. Marriages that are on the rocks, kids that are on drugs, people having affairs, people that are broke, people that are hungry. I mean, you name the list is as long as my arm, right? You know, along with people come problems. And so this is what's going on in the church. All these people show up. Well, all these people are there's a bunch of widows, there's people that are hungry. And so what do they want to do? They want to be like Christ. They want to feed them. That's what he did when they were on the side of the hill. What did he do? He fed them when they were hungry, right? So what do? We feed them. So what happens? So what happens normally? Call the pastor. He'll do it. Come on now. Don't leave me. Y'all looking at me like, I would never do that. Come on. Been here a little while. Call Mary, she'll feed you. No, but you know what I'm saying? Like, that's what, so what happens here? Acts chapter 6, it says that the early church leaders, which were the original apostles, they set the example for us as church leaders, people that you can follow. These were the people that said we should spend our time in prayer and teaching the word of God. That's what the leaders of the church do. They're not necessarily out there in the trenches feeding people. What they did is they appointed good people that had a burden for that, filled with the Spirit, that could go do it. That's her passion. She's way better at it than I. So what we do is we find people that are, I can't paint that thing. She can. I can't play music, but Grayson can. You know what I'm saying? Like you find, so what the leaders do is they spend time with the Lord. That's what they've always done. You look at all these men I talked to you about at the beginning, they spent time with the Lord. And the Lord told them to do some crazy things. But the people said, all right, we'll do it. And that's what we need to do. That's what the church of Jesus Christ needs. People need to follow their spiritual leaders. And that's hard for me to say because it sounds arrogant. But it's not arrogant. It's in the Word. And that's what we're supposed to do. Give me, so let me ask you this. I'm going to call up, Dan, could you please come up here? And Jessica, where's Kelly? I need Kelly. Did he go? Where's Kelly? Kelly! What? Dan and Kelly and Jessica are the ones, and myself, we're the ones that lead your charge. And you know us, and you love us, and we meet, and we pray, and we ask God to guide the direction of this church. That's what we do.
and we read our scriptures, and we share it with people, and that's what we do. We're doing what it says to do. I don't know what happened to Kelly. Is he okay? Is he feeling okay? Where's Kelly? Okay, so you want to stand in for him? Come here, please. It's Kelly's wife. That's close, right? The two become one flesh. Perfect. So this is what I'd like to do. I'd like to take a few moments and ask something of you. Just like Joshua here. See, Joshua heard from God, and God said, this is what I want you guys to do. This is what I want you to do. I want you to go tell them we're going to cross the Jordan River. I know this is crazy. I know it's this crazy task that's before you. It seems insurmountable. It seems like it could never get done. But I'm telling you, this is what I want of you. And I need you to be bold, and I want you to be strong, and I want you to be courageous, and I want you to follow what I said. And so in the same way that the people here in Joshua gave Joshua the gift of encouragement, and they said, listen, go talk to God and go listen to God, and then whatever he says to do, I want you to be obedient to that and tell us what it is, and we'll do it. We'll stand behind you, and we will lead the charge. In our context here, let's think about this. Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. So what we really want to do, let's switch sides a little bit. We want to go kick a dent in hell. That's what we want to do. We want to go shut them down. That's what we want to do. We want to push back darkness in the golden triangle so far that you have to look high and far and wide to find any darkness. That's what we want to do. That's what these folks are committed to, and I'm committed to. And I want you to commit to that as well. I'm not asking for blood. I'm not asking for money. I'm asking that you would trust us and follow our leading. And so what I would like for you to do is to take the next couple of moments and simply pray for us. Just you and God, put the lights down, it's just quiet, and we would covet your prayers as we decide what to do. We've got issues at hand all the time, from the weekly things, the daily things, of what songs to sing, what books to study, what things to say, what things to sponsor, what person to help, what building to go to, what to pursue, and we need the Lord's guidance, and we would ask that you would pray for us, and then we'll do one more thing, and we'll call it a night. Okay, so here's the next thing. You can keep your heads down if you'd like. You all know that we started a group of pastors here in the community called Harmony. These are tremendous men of God that are leading ministries right here in your community. We are a body of believers. Like, we're a Revolution Church, but we are part of a family that spans the globe. And the churches in our community are not our enemy or our competition.
They are our brothers and sisters in Christ. And we want to serve side by side with them. These men, what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask Mark to bring them up in just a moment, one at a time, up on the screen. You'll see a picture of them, and you'll see the name of their church and their name. Okay? And what I'd like for you to do is to take a few moments. He'll leave each picture up for about 2 minutes. And I would ask that you would pray for those men. These men have, I've met them. They are brilliant men. They are passionate men. They are loving men. They are serving men. And they have sacrificed much to do what they do, to serve God and to serve this community. And so I would ask that you would pray for them in any way that you desire, if you desire. No, I'm not forcing you. And just lift them up in prayer so they could be guided. Here's three things I'd like to offer you to pray. One is boldness to proclaim the gospel. And in today's culture, that's becoming increasingly difficult. Pray that they're bold. Pray for perseverance, that they would keep going. Many pastors quit because the pressure's high and the reward often is low. So perseverance, boldness, and protection. I know what it feels like. That man and everyone else you'll see, they walk around with a bullseye on their back from the enemy of our souls, who doesn't want to ruin your day. He wants to kill them and ruin their church and ruin their families. To pray for them that God would protect them so they could be bold and persevere in their ministry. Please pray for them. can't read that. That on the left is Luis Fuentes from Legacy Church in the Mall, and Sean McCracken, the lead pastor at Church of Whistling Pines on the right. Tough to read. That's Leon Bloder. He is the pastor across the street, First Presbyterian of Eustis. asked that the people would pray for him, that they would have opportunities to share the gospel. And he followed up by asking those same people to pray that they would be bold when given those opportunities. And so I would ask that you continue to pray in that fashion for these men who sacrificed much for the gospel. The scriptures tell us that people will know us by the way we love one another. And this right here, what you've done, is one of the greatest ways you can show the world that we love one another. That we're not enemies or in competition, we're one family.